Welcome to the Houston Maritime Museum. It's great to see you. This is getting to be a regular thing here. We've been here, the last 3 weeks? I think a lot of you have been. And we'll have a break for a few weeks. We don't have another lecture until towards the end of April. Thank you all for being here tonight. As usual, I have a couple of basic things to... How many new people here? Has everyone been here? Oh, wow. Awesome. Right. Well, welcome. The museum is... we have all kinds of lectures we have lots and lots of programs at the museum, lectures such as this. We have a family day, which will be not this Saturday, but next Saturday. And that is a really, really fun event where we have activities for children all around maritime stories. Very, very cool. Last Saturday, we opened a new exhibit that we have at the museum, which is on the USS Houston, and that was really a super, it was a great event. We have a lot of people come by the museum, so we're excited to have you here tonight. I would like to ask you, every time we have a lecture, I want to remind everyone, please like us on Facebook, because, you know, we've got to get out there and have the world know about who we are. So anyway, look up Houston Maritime Museum. I would like to, this is going to be a really interesting program. We're very excited about this, and I'm going to introduce Denton Florian to you all tonight. I met him last year at an event that was a Texas Navy event, and he has a really fantastic story. He has produced, I'm going to read you a little bit about him, but he is, obviously, he's a very, very enthusiastic scholar of American history. He organized and led the team that produced a celebrated documentary on Sam Houston. The documentary went on to win 5 Emmy Awards, and tonight, if you've never seen a real Emmy Award, there's one on the back table. It's really cool. I was hoping somebody would come and present it to me, but no one, I don't think that's going to happen.
Not yet.
He is created the, so this film is what we're going to talk about tonight, and obviously Sam Houston. He represents the largest collection of digital information on Sam Houston's life that's ever been assembled. So we're going to talk, and we've already had a couple of conversations tonight about the new museum, because obviously we want to talk about Sam Houston and the new museum. Mr. Florian is a native Texan, a graduate of both University of Texas and Texas State University. He is a Boy Scout leader, a backpacker, photographer, a fisherman, and airline transport rated instructor. And he enjoys the outdoors. And obviously, we're going to have a great program. So, Mr. Florian.
Well, thank you for coming, and thank you for inviting me to come. This is really the funnest thing that we get to do, come out and talk to people, and I always enjoy doing that, and because, you know, you're buried for so long in the edit suite, working in isolation, and sometimes you occasionally stick your head up and you wonder if anybody notices or cares what you're doing. And so getting to come out and reveal some of what we've done is really kind of fun. So have any of you all seen the movie? Have you seen it or anything? Okay. It's played on PBS. Okay. Well, it has played on PBS all over Texas, and I'll tell you a little bit about the movie a little bit later, and I want to tell you kind of a little bit about Sam's life, kind of bookend his life, to give you the Reader's Digest version of his life anyway. And I'll try to move through that at a fairly rapid pace so that we can get to the question and answers. And anything that you guys want to talk about with respect to Houston's life, then we can cover that when we get there. And I'm also one of these people that just likes to talk to folks, so I'm not offended by questions, or if I say something and you don't understand, just holler at me or throw something or raise your hand or something, and we'll deal with it right then. But Sam was... he was born in the Shenandoah Valley of Virginia, which is where Robert E. Lee is from, and Stonewall Jackson, and, you know, that storied valley particularly is so beautiful and associated with the Civil War. And that's where Sam came from Rockbridge County. And his father was a major with the Continental Army, served under George Washington and Daniel Morgan's Rifle Brigade. And I'm fascinated to find out if his dad was a cowpens. I know Daniel Morgan's rifle brigade was a cowpens. I don't know if Samuel Houston, Major Samuel Houston, was there or not. It shouldn't be too hard to find out. But he died, Samuel Houston, Major Samuel Houston, Sam's father, died when Sam was about 13 years old. And the mother, Elizabeth Paxton, moved everybody to what was then the West, which is today Eastern Tennessee. And she patented a farm on 419 acres. And then she opened a store. Is that going to help? She opened a store, and Sam didn't like storekeeping, and he didn't like farming either, so that presented a problem, you know. He ended up, Elizabeth and Major Houston had six sons in a row, followed by three daughters. And their first four sons were very studious and dutiful type of guys. And two of them actually died, Paxton, Robert, James, and John. Paxton and Robert died, and the ones that lived were James and John. And they gave Sam such a hard time that he started calling them the Holy Apostles. And he just couldn't stand it anymore, so he ran away to go live with the Indians. And the Indians, this is a band of Cherokee, about 300 of them, and they were living on Hiawassee Island in the middle of the Tennessee River, a beautiful place. Was there last year, and Sam loved it. You know, he appreciated their oneness with nature, and just nobody demanded that he work, and he could kind of hang out and do whatever he wanted to do. So he used to make little trips back home to Maryville, Tennessee, and he ran up debt at the family store, and so he opened up a little one-house school. One-room schoolhouse, rather, and taught school for a spell to pay off his debts. And which is interesting for a guy who hated school and never had more than, you know, a year of formal schooling himself. But he did. It was very successful. He paid off his debts. He said that was his favorite job, by the way. Any school teachers in here? School teaching was his favorite job that he ever had. And so, you know, again, long story short, trying to compress it for you to get it all in, for the time being anyway, he joined the Army after living with the Indians for 3 years. He was horribly wounded in Alabama at the Battle of Horseshoe Bend, fighting with Andrew Jackson. His military career was really over at that point because he physically couldn't do that job anymore. He was just shot up at Horseshoe Bend and left for dead on the battlefield. And so his mentors kind of helped him on to other things, and he studied the law, and he became a lawyer. He completed a year and a half worth of study and passed the bar in 6 months. You know, so he truly had a gigantic mind, and he practiced law off and on for most of his life. And I was giving a talk in New Braunfels, where I lived for a couple of years, and I think it was the Rotary Club, and I figured out a great way to, that's a lesser known fact about Sam, that he was a lawyer, that he practiced law all that time, but I figured a great way to bring this fact out maybe would be to start out on kind of a lighter note. I'd tell a couple of good lawyer jokes, you know. So the problem was that none of my friends in the audience who were attorneys thought they were funny, and nobody else in the audience thought they were jokes. You know, that we moved through that and talked about his legal career for a little bit. He became essentially the Attorney General of the state of Tennessee. He got elected to Congress. He represented the 9th District from Tennessee in the United States House of Representatives, and eventually got himself elected governor. While he was governor, then as now, really, if you're going to rise in politics, for whatever reason, you really kind of have to be married. I think that's just expected, a tradition, I don't know, but I think we've only had one bachelor president, James Buchanan. And so Sam was on his way up, and he needed to get married, and so he met this girl, and she was from a very prominent family in Sumner County in Gallatin. And, you know, their marriage collapsed almost immediately. Like, I mean, it was never consummated. I don't know the the first night, and then they kept up appearances for the public for about 10 weeks before it completely collapsed. And this is still a big stew pot of controversy. Everybody wants to know what happened to the marriage, why did it fail, what went on there. We really don't know. We've got a couple of pretty good guesses, but the truth is nobody really knows because neither one of them ever talked about it. Sam, what we do know is that she left him. What we think is that she was in love with somebody else, and she was from a very prominent family, and they kind of pushed her to the altar, and by the time she came to her senses, you know, she was married, and Sam saw her that night just weeping over this pile of letters from the, I think, to the guy that she was really in love with, and devastated Sam. And so back then, if you get a divorce, you're done. Okay, it's over. And so his career was shattered and destroyed. He was personally devastated because he was deeply in love with this girl. And he asked the church for some guidance or help or sympathy or something, and the church said no. The two pastors that married him, they turned their back on him. So he had, there was nothing left. He told his friends, I've got nothing left here. You know, I'm out of here. And I'm going to go live with my Indian family again. Well, by now, they were in Oklahoma, what is today Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. They had voluntarily moved. This is way before the Trail of Tears or anything like that. And they had moved from eastern Tennessee to the Indian Territory. And Sam said, I'm gone. And so he went to go live with them and did for an additional 3 years. And while he was there, as a matter of fact, her brothers, Eliza Allen's brothers, chased him down on the riverboat in the Cumberland River and said, you've got to say something. People are going to talk about our sister. You know, you've got to say something. He said, it's nobody's business. He said, it's a private affair. It's nobody's business. You know, go take a hike. And they said, people are going to talk about our sister. You've got to say something. He said, okay. He said, print this in the Nashville paper. You tell them that I said, if anybody says anything derogatory about Eliza Allen, I will come back and write the libel in the accuser's blood. Print that. I'm out of here. And so, very touching scene. He gets off the boat in Weber's Falls, and there on the by torchlight, meeting him on the bank of the river, was his adopted father, the Indian, the Cherokee chief, Uluteka, known to the whites as John Jolly. And he threw his arms around him and said, I've heard that a dark cloud has come over the white path that you were walking. It's been 11 winters since you and I have seen each other. And when this cloud fell in your way, you turned your thoughts to my wigwam. He said, I'm glad of it. This is of the Great Spirit. You know, my home is yours, my people is yours. He basically threw his arms around him and said, it's good to see you, let's go get something to eat. Does that remind you of anything? You know, so here's these two knuckleheads back in Nashville who were supposed to represent the church and everything, and here's this guy who they would condemn as a savage, and he's behaving in a more Christ-like manner than they were. So Sam goes with John Jolly, and he hangs out with the Indians for 3 years. Now, he was already very close to Andrew Jackson. And the Indians knew this, and Sam became an Indian agent and conducted business between the U.S. government and the Cherokee tribe there. One of the things he found when he got there was that he found a bunch of corrupt U.S. Indian agents operating in the Indian Territory. They were running slaves, running liquor, all kinds of stuff, and Sam broke all that up. And he made quite a few enemies in Washington, D.C., having done so. And so one day he's in Washington, and he went back to Washington dressed as a Cherokee. He escorted a bunch of Cherokee chiefs to Washington. And John C. Calhoun had a hissy fit over that and really bawled him out for being out of uniform, because he was technically still a U.S. Army officer. And the mouthpiece of all of these people that were trying to get after Sam, and they essentially accused Houston of the corruption from the floor of the House. And there was a guy named William Stanberry. He was a U.S. representative from Ohio. And so Sam wrote him, and Sam said, hey, I heard that, you know, something was said. Now, these are Southern gentlemen, okay? Honor, this is a big deal, okay? Today, you can call somebody anything you want to, and it doesn't matter. But back then, if you impugned somebody's character, it was, you know, it was a big deal. So Sam wrote Stanberry, said, you know, I heard this was said. What's your side of it? Did you really say this? Stanberry ignored him, never answered him, never returned any of his letters or anything. So one night, you know, on Pennsylvania Avenue, Sam caught him out on the street, just beat the living daylights out of him with a cane. I mean, and Stanberry, in the middle of this fight, pulled a pistol out of his jacket and stuck it in Sam's chest and pulled the trigger and it misfired. So there's a whole bunch of history that almost didn't happen. And so Sam was placed on trial in the House of Representatives. It was a big trial. Dr. Greg Cantrell said it was the hottest entertainment ticket in town in Washington, D.C. People packed the galleries, and Sam hired Francis Scott Key to be his defense counsel of the Star Spangled Banner fame. Francis Scott Key was too hungover to defend him, so Sam had to defend himself, but Sam was also hungover, and he even told the guy, he said, look, he said, wake me up in the morning and give me coffee, and if the coffee sticks, then take this purse of money and hire a barber and clean me up, and if I throw up the coffee, then take this gun and shoot me. So I think he threw up the first cup of coffee, but the guy didn't kill him, and he patched him up and sent him on his way. And James Haley said that Houston gave this window-rattling oratory. He got standing ovations, and I mean, it was really quite a performance. And Sam was an actor. He was given to all this, you know, all this drama. And I wish I could have seen that performance. But anyway, he gave it, and the problem is he was guilty. So, in the end, he was found guilty, and the Speaker of the House, you know, called him from the well of the he called him to the well of the House, and he said, "I am required by circumstances to issue the admonishment upon you, and so you are admonished." And that's about as far as it went. And what's important about this, though, is Houston could have easily disappeared in the Indian Territory after he left Tennessee. He could have easily disappeared from history right there. And this incident in Washington made him, or gave him a national stage again. It put him in front of the people again, gave him an opportunity to rise and speak and be seen and everything. And it made him useful to Andrew Jackson again. And so Jackson sent him to Texas. And he had been trying to buy Texas for a long time, and Mexico wouldn't take his check. So he said, go down there and find out what's going on in that place and let me know, get back to me. Now, there's also a lot of speculation about what were his real intentions. You know, Dr. Frank De La Teja said that we don't have any proof that his intention was to foment revolution and stir things up. But he said, I think he understood that there was a future relationship with the United States that was going to be close, and whatever that looked like or wherever the seams were, he was going to identify them and you know, try to pull Texas into the orbit of the United States and away from Mexico. But there was a lot of stuff going on when Sam got here already, so it's not like he got here and started it. So Sam crossed the Red River into Texas on December 2nd of 1832 and went to Nacogdoches and spent the night. He got baptized into the Catholic faith there because that was a requirement to own land. It's kind of a joke to everybody, but you know, it was a legal thing, and there was no theology behind it for most of these people is what I'm getting at. But if you were going to come here and get a land grant, you had to be a member of the Catholic Church. So Sam did that, and then he rode to San Felipe de Austin, not too far from here, just on the west side of Houston. And that's where he met Jim Bowie. And they had dinner on Christmas Eve, and then about a week later they rode to San Antonio together. And Sam rode from there all the way back to Natchitoches, Louisiana, and rode Andrew Jackson and said, hey, this place is beautiful. You know, I'll never forget my home country, but I'm going to live in Texas the rest of my life. So you fast forward a little bit to the Texas Revolution, and Sam was able to present himself as somebody who had frontier military experience. He was close with Andrew Jackson. He was He was very tall. He was about 6'2", which is not short today, but it was gigantic back then. Some little old lady asked me after a talk one time, she said, asked me how tall I was. I told her I was 6'6". And she said, oh, Sam Houston was 6'6". I said, no, Sam Houston was 6'2". And when I get promoted to glory, I'm never going to let him forget it either. So sometimes I tell people I'm 5'18", and half of them walk away confused. So Sam, you know, it's important, I think, to look at him and understand he was kind of a latecomer to Texas. He wasn't one of the early guys. Stephen F. Austin got here in 1821. Sam got here 11 years later. And suddenly he's in charge of everything. And so somehow he had this charisma, he had this aura about him, this commanding presence that allowed people to give him their trust. And he took charge of the army and began to recruit people. And he's been viciously criticized for the way he conducted the San Jacinto campaign until the battle. You know, there were a bunch of people that wanted him to fight on the Colorado. And he knew it would be suicide if he did that. I mean, he had this hapless band of volunteer soldiers, ragtag bunch, hot-headed bunch. And he was facing thousands of disciplined professional troops. They had one shot at this, and that's all. From the, what is today, March 7th? Okay, the Alamo fell yesterday. Sam was in Gonzales, and a couple days later, Susanna Dickinson shows up in Gonzales with word that the Alamo has fallen and Santa Ana is on his way. He's coming after you. And so they immediately struck camp, burned Gonzales to the ground, and started to put distance between himself. Sam started to put distance between himself and the Mexican army. And they played this cat and mouse game until April 21st. So, horrible event, disease, starvation. It rained constantly. There was mud, there was deprivation. It was just, it was not fun. It was a bad deal. And a lot of people died. Kay Bailey Hutchison, we interviewed her for the film, and she said that she's a direct descendant of Charles S. Taylor, who was an important figure in Nacogdoches. And Charles S. Taylor's first four children died during the runaway strike. So these were Senator Hutchison's direct ancestors that died during this thing. So it was bad. San Jacinto happens, the Texans win the battle, Santa Ana gets captured, and Sam wants Texas to join the United States immediately. And the only reason we weren't a state right away is because the United States wouldn't have us. It would upset the slave state, free state balance in the Senate. And so Sam wrote to Andrew Jackson and pleading with him to find a way to annex Texas into the Union, and Jackson couldn't get it done. So he said, well, we're going to have to go it alone, and he began to form a country. They printed currency, and they did all these other things to form ourselves into a republic, but he never stopped trying to maneuver Texas into the United States. And it's interesting the way he did it. Now, Lamar's dream was for Texas to expand to California, to the coast, and be the continental equal of the United States, the rival of the United States. And had that happened, you know, Lamar would be the big hero. His star would shine a whole lot brighter than it does today. But Sam began trying to get Texas into a position to where the United States would favorably look upon us and annex us. And the way he did it, he knew the only thing really that got under Andrew Jackson's skin, more than anything else, was the British. He had a visceral hatred of the British. And, I don't see any kids in the room. I'll tell you what he said. You what? Okay, all right, well, I'll sort of tell you what he said. Sam was about 10 years old during the American Revolution, and he was in an area that was quartered by redcoats and everything, and one of his British officers looked at Andrew Jackson and demanded that he shine his boots. And 10-year-old Andrew Jackson looked at him and said, "Shine your own blankety blank boots." And the guy pulled the sword out and slashed him across the face, and Andrew Jackson had a scar on his face the rest of his life. But if there's one person you probably don't want to do that to, Andrew Jackson's probably not the guy that I would, you know, slash with a sword across the face. And Jackson never forgot that, and he never forgave the British. And that told, and you know, Jackson and Houston were like father and son. And that, but Sam knew exactly what to do. So he would snub the American charge d'affaires on the dais next to him when he was the president of Texas, and he would have the British charge sitting there, and he would say all these flowery things about Her Britannic Majesty and all these treaties of commerce and amity that he was working on and all this, knowing that the alarm bells are going to ring back in Washington, D.C. when word gets out about this. And they did, and the United States sucked us up into the Union like a vacuum cleaner. Jackson said, "My gosh," he said, they've got Florida, they've got Oregon, they've got the British West Indies. If they get Texas too, we'll be surrounded by this iron hoop of British protectorate, and we'll never break out of it. It'll take millions of dollars and oceans of blood to get out of this." So, Sam, it was just 24 karat Houston. He played him like a fiddle. And, you know, and later, Andrew Jackson wrote Sam, even in the midst of this, and he said, "What are you doing?" He said, "You can't betray your native country this way and all this, you know." And so when Sam told him after it was over and laid his cards on the table and told him what his game was, Jackson said, "I knew British gold could never buy Sam Houston," and all this kind of stuff. But he had him going, you know, for sure. And so Sam, this is when Sam and Thomas Rusk became the first two senators from the brand new state of Texas, the 28th state. And he even wrote to Margaret. He said, "My fellow Texans will be glad to know that Rusk and I are the tallest members of the Senate." So that's probably where the whole long, tall Texan stuff started and originated, was back then. But he wanted everybody to know that he and Rusk were the tallest ones there. And very shortly after he gets to the Senate, and I've skipped over a couple of romance things I'll get back to, the fires of secession start getting really hot. Sam was always a Union man, a strong Union man. He had a passionate reverence for the United States, almost a religious patriotism. And he also was very well traveled in the North. Unlike a lot of these other Southern hotheads, Sam knew the North. He traveled up there a lot. He was very popular in the North. And he had one foot on each side of the Mason-Dixon line, so his perspective was different. And all these people down here, one of us can whip 10 of you, and all this stuff was just disconnected from reality. And he said, "You're going to pick a fight with the North? Let me tell you, you're going to get it handed to you with a bayonet. It's not going to be this thing you think. This isn't going to be fun. This is going to be a bloody mess." And nobody would listen to him. He filibustered the Kansas-Nebraska Act for 2 days with a pile of books, and he went down in flames. And most historians today, I'm not a Civil War historian, I'm somewhat of a Civil War buff, but all those guys will tell you, most of them, that when the Kansas-Nebraska Act passed, the Civil War was a matter of time, that was the final straw. So the Kansas-Nebraska Act in 1854 opened up the Kansas and Nebraska territory to slavery if the people there voted for it. It was a Stephen Douglas thing, and Sam knew it was a sham. He said, "You can't do this. By the way, you promised all this land in perpetuity to the Indians anyway. Nobody noticed or cared." And so he filibustered this thing, and he went down in flames, and he came home to Texas, and he was in Independence. I was just there last week. And he told Rufus Burleson, one of the founders of Baylor University, and Burleson was the pastor of that little Baptist church that's still there in Independence. He was all depressed, and he said, "Sam, what's the matter?" And he said, "I can tell you exactly what's going to happen." He said, "2 years from now, the Free Soilers and the Abolitionists are going to get together and form a new political party. And in 1860, they will elect the president. When that happens, the South will secede, and we're going to have a civil war." "Oh, Sam," he said, no, you don't understand. That's exactly what's happening." And he said, Both sides will predict a quick victory, but it's going to be this long, drawn-out, bloody mess. And my beloved South, he said, will go down in a sea of blood and smoking ruin. And the North will think they've won this big victory, but the North will have their own price to pay. He said the North will reap a bitter harvest of assassination. He said that in 1854. You know, it's creepy. Some of the stuff he said, that history unfolded and played out exactly the way he said it would. So he got himself elected governor, which is amazing. He ran for governor in 1857 and lost to a guy named Hardin Runnels. And he campaigned just endlessly for that election and lost it. He ran again in 1859 and only made one speech and he won the election. I guess everybody figured out Hardin Runnels wasn't the greatest governor, wasn't the guy they wanted anymore. So Sam wins the election and becomes the governor of Texas. He ran for governor because the Texas legislature threw him out of the Senate. Okay, back then, the legislature decided who the senators were, and the Texas legislature yanked him out of there, and he was ridiculed for it, and his other senators made fun of him. But that's where he wore this leopard skin vest. Have y'all seen the vest? Anything? You can go to this. You can see this vest in Huntsville. They have it at the museum. And he said he wore that vest as a symbol of defiance. You know, for his unionism. He said, gentlemen, the good book says a leopard can't change his spots. And I'm going to be for the union till the day I die because our country shouldn't be torn apart. So he ran for governor, became the governor of Texas, and the Texas seceded, and they, just to rub his nose in it, they passed a law that said all state office holders had to swear an oath of allegiance to the new Confederacy. And Sam had to decide what to do. And when we filmed in the governor's mansion, I wanted to film that upstairs hallway where he paced all night, March 15, 1861, trying to decide what he was going to do. And Margaret was downstairs and she said I could hear him all night pacing. And then he would stop and kneel and pray. And then he would pace some more. And he came down the next morning and he said, Margaret, he said, I'll never do it. I'll never sign that piece of paper. And he didn't. And they ejected him from office. He lost his governorship. And on his way home, and Lincoln, by the way, offered him 50,000 troops and a major general's commission if he would try to keep Texas in the Union. And he really had to think about that one. He sought the counseling of some good friends, even some secessionist friends. Representative Throckmorton was there, and I have to fact check the others. I've forgotten at this moment off the top of my head. I've lost it. But they met in the library of the governor's mansion, and he said only one of them counseled him to take Lincoln up on it. But he said, gentlemen, I'm not going to do this, but if I were 10 years younger, maybe I'd have a go at it. And so he dropped the letter into that fireplace there in the library of the governor's mansion. And they let us light a fire in that fireplace when we filmed. I asked, and I was shocked when the lady said yes. And I was like, you know, get the fire going before somebody walks in here and tells us we can't, you know. And so when you get to that part of the movie and you see that fire and we're talking about the letter, that's not the fireplace in my house. That's the actual fireplace where that letter was actually burned. And we did that on numerous occasions. You know, the baptism scene is not the pond out in some pasture someplace. That's the actual pool of water where Sam Houston was actually baptized. So anyway, he's on his way home from Austin, and he passes through Brenham. And there was a lot of the San Jacinto veterans were in Brenham. And one of them, named Hugh McIntyre, was kind of the grand poobah of the area. He was the president of the Chamber of Commerce, okay, and the Rotary Club president, and whoever, that guy, that was Hugh McIntyre. So he invited Sam Houston to speak, and Sam politely declined, and then this truculent secessionist declared that Sam Houston would not be allowed to speak, and you can imagine what General Houston had to say about that. He said, well, you know, I've never not spoken my mind, and I believe now's a pretty good time. I think I will speak. So he'd been advised not to give this speech. He'd been advised that his life was probably in jeopardy. It was really that bad. And so with a nod to the language again. McIntyre got up there, and it's really just a moving scene. He got up in front of everybody, and he quieted them down, and he said, "I'm for secession too. I'm with you fellas. But this man has earned the right to speak, and we're going to hear what he has to say." And then he pulled his .44 out of his coat, and he said, "The first one of you blankety blankety blanks to cause any trouble, I'll kill you." And they all shut up. And Sam passionately, you know, made his case, tried to tell them they'll do this, and they didn't listen. And just a very short time later, he gave the same speech from the balcony of the Tremont Hotel in Galveston. And there were dirt streets, of course, and there was a horse down on the street that kicked his way out of the harness, and the owner did what anybody would do. He took a 2x4 and cracked the horse between the ears and put him back in the harness. And Sam said, now, he said, "Old Dobbins, he's just practicing a little practical secession down there. You see how it works?" And he always tried to warn about what was going to happen. And I thought it was very sad that he died in July of 1863. Vicksburg had just happened that month. Gettysburg had just happened. It was at the height of the Civil War. And I told James Haley, I said, "You know, it's a shame he didn't live another few years and see how it came out." And Haley said, "He knew how it came out." And I said, "Of course he did. He told everybody that." You know? But I still wish he could have lived and seen his country. It must have been just something to see everything you had ever worked for your entire life just collapse into a pile of dust and lumber and fire and just go up in flames and all the death and destruction. And he died in the middle of that. And, you know, the newspapers hated his guts. All the northern newspapers had been burned out, so there were only southern newspapers around. And a lot of these newspaper editors knew that it was going to be a big story, and so they all came to Huntsville, and they were kind of waiting for him to die, really. And one of his aides came out of the steamboat house. Houston was lying in there, and he said, everybody's gathered in the yard, and he said, "General Houston would like to see you." And General Houston would like to see you. And so they came to the door, and Sam was laying there, and he greeted him when they came to the door, and he said, "Please, would you come stand at my right-hand side here?" And the guy did. And the next one, he said, "You know, good afternoon." He said, "Please, would you come stand at my left-hand side?" And they did. And then, with a sigh of satisfaction, he leaned back on his pillow and said, "Boys, I've always wanted to die like Christ. Now I'm between two thieves, and I'm finally going to do it." That story came from Bill Hobby's mother through James Haley. And they don't know who they were. They think one of them was the editor of the Galveston paper, because Sam had been calling him a thief for 30 years. But he died there in the steamboat house, and was given and he used to go visit the Union prisoners that were in the Walsh unit there in Huntsville. So it was kind of fun to think about Sam being involved in prison ministry. But he would go visit those guys, and the ship's carpenter of the USS Harriet Lane is the one who built Sam's coffin. And if he hadn't been there, Sam probably wouldn't have had a coffin to be buried. He had a Masonic funeral. Yes, sir.
Can you tell us again what he died of?
Dr. Ashbel Smith diagnosed him, and Dr. Pleasant Kittrell also diagnosed him with severe pneumonia. I think that's probably what it was, actually. He had gone down about a month earlier to Sour Lake. His shoulder wound was bothering him. His shoulder wound never healed. I mean, he was shot when he was 20 years old, and Jeff Hamilton said that wound ran as freely the day he died as the day he got shot. He had to clean and dress that wound. I would love to hear some doctor, if there's one in the room, maybe you could offer some thoughts or something, but I can't imagine a wound not healing after that amount of time. But he'd gone to Sour Lake to try to get some relief, and it didn't work, and he came back and was slipping pretty rapidly after that. And it might be a good time. I have lots of other things we could say, but I'd like to hear what kind of questions you have, and maybe we could go in that direction. Yes, sir.
What was it, his left shoulder?
It was his right shoulder. And he took an arrow, and we delicately say the upper thigh. It was more like the groin. That was removed, and people have said that that was the, there's been some speculation even back to his first marriage that maybe that was an issue or something, but Ashbel Smith wrote up his medical condition later in his life, and he described a scar on his thigh where the arrow was. So I don't know how he would have ridden a horse all those years if that was the wound that never healed. But Jeff Hamilton also said it was the shoulder wounds that never healed. And Sam, you know, his handwriting gets really bad when he's writing Margaret and his shoulder's bothering him. His handwriting is hard to read. And he would say things to Margaret in writing. I've been reading his mail about 10 years now. And he would say things like, you know, a bone chip worked its way out of my shoulder tonight. Or something. So you just, the suffering is just really hard. Yes, sir.
His ankle was shattered in San Jacinto, too, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. His,
and he lived the rest of his life with used a cane?
He did. He was shot in the left ankle. The painting you've seen that hangs in the Capitol got it wrong. The painting shows his right ankle bandaged up. It was actually his left ankle. But he took a Mexican musket ball in the ankle there, yeah. And, yes?
I have a question. So his prophecy, but I mean his, what, when he, had he studied military history? I mean, what was it that helped him sort of come up with, I mean, being able to see what was going to happen that far in the future as far as he had some more than just average political and historical education to be able to come up with something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, where did his prescience come from and all that? One thing to know about Sam is that, you know, today everybody has one of these, especially the kids. With Sam, he had the Iliad. Sam's father, Major Samuel Houston, had one of the finest libraries on the frontier. And Sam immersed himself in the Greeks and the great literature of the past, particularly Homer, and memorized huge passages of the Iliad. And I went back and took a course on the Iliad. I reread it. It's pretty tough sledding, frankly, but if you want to understand Sam Houston, that's very helpful. Because the hero in, who is the hero in the Iliad? It's Hector, right? And he's this great warrior, but he's also a very tender family man. And the more I read about Hector and the more I read Homer, the more Sam Houston came into focus, you know, and I said, wow, that's where all this came from. He also had military experience under Andrew Jackson. He watched Jackson try to control a ragtag volunteer army of people who were, you know, frankly insubordinate and everything else. Of course, Jackson had one of them shot, and so that sobered him up pretty quick. Sam was dealing with an insubordinate army himself and a bunch of mutinous yahoos, and he, one of them he allowed to be put on court-martial, suffer a court-martial, and he was sentenced to death, and Sam let that go until the very last minute, and Sam finally gave him a reprieve at the very last minute. But Andrew Jackson would have had him shot. And I think Sam noticed the effect that had on the Army, on the 39th Infantry in Andrew Jackson's day, and he realized he could probably affect the same result without actually killing the guy. And frankly, he needed him. He needed all the rifles he could get. Yes, sir?
Can you reflect on the decision-making and the public opinion that surrounded not supporting the Alamo or sending troops to the Alamo?
Sam's opinion of the Alamo was that the Alamo was a death trap. And he was right. He said it's indefensible. It's of no strategic value whatsoever. It's out there on the edge of the frontier. We can't defend it. He said what we need to do, he told Jim Bowie, to abandon the Alamo. He said, bring me the gunpowder and the cannons and get out of there. But he did say to Jim Bowie and to send word to Neil on January 29th to, he said, but you can use your own judgment. So he gave him some wiggle room, which I think is a great thing from a management standpoint. The people closest to the action, closest to the ground, are often have the best information and can make the best decisions. And in this case, unfortunately, Sam was proven right. They got there and fell under the spell of the place and stayed. But Sam wanted everybody to pull back behind these big rivers where they were closer to the United States and closer to supplies and closer to more volunteers where they could build themselves up into an army and train as an army that could take on Santa Ana. And he never had the chance to do that. So, yes, sir.
What was his role in the tactics of San Jacinto victory?
You know, there's been a lot of talk about whether Sam was in control. As they were, and on our website, samhoustonmovie.com, there's several maps. I was popping GPS coordinates all over the places we were traveling around. One of the things we did is we documented all the campsites of the Texas Army during the San Jacinto campaign by GPS. So you can go to our website, look at that map, and see the path they followed and where they camped. And we often know exactly where they camped. Sometimes we don't. We know it was in this general area somewhere, but a lot of times we do know the exact spot. And as they got closer and closer to Houston, today's Houston, they got to a place about 9 miles on the other side of Tomball. It's right off 2920, New Kentucky Park. You can go there today. And there was the Witchway Tree.
It's the park there.
Is he? Yep. The home of Abram Roberts was there, and there was a fork in the road, and one fork went south to San Jacinto, and the other fork went north to Nacogdoches and safety. And everybody was viciously accusing Houston, even of cowardice. And they were afraid he was going to take the left fork and go up to Nacogdoches, and had he done that, they probably wouldn't have followed him at that point. He would have probably lost control of the army. But and there's a lot of speculation about who called Collins right. Did Sam, you know, run out in front of them and say, I'm running out to get in front because I'm their leader, whether he was really leading. My answer to all that is that if Sam Houston wasn't in control of his army, then why wasn't Santa Ana swinging from that tree? You know, only Sam Houston stood between Santa Ana and a bullet, a rope, or a blade. And we've all seen that picture where the one I talked about earlier, where Sam's lying underneath the tree with a bullet in his leg and all the guys are standing around. The Alamo had just happened. Goliad had just happened. This horrific event, the runaway scrape, had just taken place. These guys had their farms had been molested. Their families had been uprooted. A bunch of their friends were killed. Their family, their children had died and that kind of stuff. The iron was pretty hot. And Sam, let me tell you, he had a volcanic temper. So he had to be burning. And it's amazing to me that he was able to rein in his own stuff and said, no, that's not the right thing to do. All those guys, you can imagine what they thought ought to be done to Santa Ana. And so Houston spared Santa Ana's life, and if he wasn't in control of his army, Santa Ana's a dead man. Yes, sir.
Santa Ana seems to have not responded very well to his parole. Wouldn't it have been better to have strung him up and been done with it?
Great question. Wouldn't it have been better to strung him up? There are two reasons. The principal, I don't know the principal. I'll tell you the two reasons why he didn't do that. Why didn't he kill Santa Ana? He certainly deserved it. Amen to that, right? One of the biggest reasons is only Santa Ana was defeated. Felo Solo was still out there. Gaona was still out there. Sesma, all these other, there were thousands of other Mexican troops still in the field under these other generals. And had they pressed the attack, Houston's hot-headed little bunch of guys would have been wiped out like that, and they would have disappeared from history, and, you know, things would be very different today. So Houston used Santa Ana as a kind of a diplomatic bargaining chip to get the other troops to back off. And but he also said, so he had very pragmatic military reasons for sparing his life, but he also said that civilized countries don't do that. That's the way banana republics change power, is they kill the guy that was in power before we took over. You know, we're better than that, and we have to be better than that. What we're trying to build here is something very different than a banana republic, and we're not going to behave that way. So we had moral reasons for doing that also for Sparrow. Was there? Yes, sir.
Given his relationships with people in the United States, did he not try and get supplies, etc., for the army from the U.S.?
Oh, yes, he did. The question is, given his relationships in the United States, didn't he try to get supplies from the United States for his army? The answer is yes, and the answer is he did. Primarily from General Gaines, who the U.S. Army was piled up on the Sabine River, and Gaines looked the other way, really, as some of his men changed out of their uniforms and supplies started pouring in from the United States to help. Let me get him and I'll come right back to you. Yes, sir.
This isn't a question, but I was in Galveston last week and spent the afternoon at the Bryan Museum.
Right.
Which, if people have never been to it, is incredible. And an afternoon is not nearly enough time, but and talking about San Jacinto, there's a diorama there that's as big as the whole first part of this room, which is just incredible to see in this detail. So check out that museum in Galveston.
Yeah, the Bryan Museum, J.P. Bryan's Museum in Galveston, is truly wonderful. Yes, sir.
I don't see a parallel between San Jacinto and the Battle of Horseshoe Bend, when Andrew Jackson attacks the Cree and defeats them. But if you look at Horseshoe Bend, in a way, the guys didn't have a way out. They had the river behind them. If you look at San Jacinto, I think that Sam Houston thought that, well, I have been here before. He had the Mexicans with backs against, you know, the San Jacinto River. He had the Buffalo Bayou behind him, but the Mexicans really didn't have a place to go.
No, they didn't. And the Mexican, this is a parallel between the Battle of Horseshoe Bend and San Jacinto. Santa Anna's group was backed in. His military advisors told him, so, I mean, Santa Anna had generals that were smart and good guys, but, you know, he said, these dictators are all the same in this regard. They're the smartest guy in the room. They know everything, you know, and he didn't listen to them, and he was very arrogant. He wasn't really, he should have been concerned about Houston, but he wasn't. He thought he got him whooped and whatever. I'll take care of him on my time. And so there was one way away from that battlefield, Vince's Bridge, and Sam Houston had it burned. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so now it's a battle to the death for all of us, he told his men. And you know, I also think it's important, Juan Seguin's entire first command was wiped out at the Alamo. And Juan Seguin's second command fought at his insistence at San Jacinto because Houston wanted him to babysit the camp. He thought, well, they're going to be mistaken for the enemy, they'll be hit by friendly fire or something like that. And Juan Seguin said, you cannot keep us out of this fight. He said, we don't win this thing. We live in San Antonio. We don't win this thing. We don't have homes to go back to. So, you know, the Tejanos have a wonderful heritage in fighting tyranny and dictatorship, and they need to be taught that because it's the truth. After Santa Anna took over, you know, he ran as a big states' rights guy, a man of the people and all that kind of stuff, and once he got elected, he declared himself to be the dictator, and everybody answers to me now. The city of Zacatecas in Mexico rebelled, and he sent his goons in there and killed 5,000 of his own citizens. And civil war broke out in four other Mexican states, you know, aside from Texas. Texas and Coahuila were, you know, together, but nobody liked this guy. And I think one of the biggest differences between Sam Houston, one of the big differences between Houston and Santa Anna is Houston's ability to control his emotions and make the right decision and not the decision that would be, I mean, for example, I was talking to Dr. Stephen Harden, and I said, you know, if Santa Anna had just sent 500 troops to tie down the Alamo, and he said, forget the Alamo. And I said, of course, forget the Alamo. What if he just swung east, captured Fannin and all those guys at Goliad, and paroled them back to the United States instead of slaughtering them in cold blood? when they got off the boat in New Orleans, they would have been dejected, they would have been humiliated, they would have said, Texas? You know, forget that godforsaken place. But when he killed everybody at the Alamo, and then he shot everybody in cold blood, unarmed men at Goliad, the seed of his own destruction was within him. And he fed it, and you know, if he had behaved differently, then history would have played out very differently. We don't know how, but it would have been very different. So, yes, sir.
What was the development of Houston as a Mason, and how did the Masonic order, do you think, affect him and his judgment and his governance?
Houston was a passionate Mason, as many of those guys were. The question usually comes up about, did Houston spare Santa Ana's life out of Masonic respect? And he didn't. There's no evidence for that. But he spared him for all the reasons we've already talked about. He established some of the first lodges in Texas. He's very passionate. In fact, he had a Masonic funeral. This was interesting. When we filmed the funeral scene in Huntsville, the Order of Masons, the lodge that was there, came and we filmed those guys during the funeral scene. So when you get to that scene, those are actual, not just actual Masons, but Masons who are members of the lodge. Those are Sam's lodge brothers, you know, in that scene. So that was really just kind of meaningful to us to do. And let me tell you, I'll take one question and then I'll tell you something about the film. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm kind of curious when you've gotten to know the man and you think about our perfect political situation now with the press and everything, and we rip everybody apart that wants to run for office. Would a person like Sam Houston even have a chance today, or were there too many things that had happened in his life that would make too much good press but destroy him as far as the populace is concerned?
Well, it's interesting. He didn't run for president. Everybody thought he would follow Andrew Jackson into the White House. He didn't run, and he didn't run because Margaret didn't want him to. I'll tell you something about Margaret. I kind of skipped over her, and I can't do that, really. The stories of his past wildness would have certainly been a big issue at the time. All of his wild days were really prior to him coming to Texas. Once the Sam Houston who crossed the Red River and came into Texas was a very different person than the Sam Houston of the earlier time. Margaret, I don't think you can understand Sam apart from the Greeks. I don't think you can understand Houston apart from his relationship with Native Americans, or his relationship with Andrew Jackson, or his relationship with Margaret Lee from Alabama. His wife was... he was very, very close. They had a soulmate relationship. They remind me a lot of John and Abigail Adams, really. And he was quite a number of years her senior. When they married, he was 47, she was 20. Mm-hmm. But she really put a lot of his pieces in place. She was a very devout Baptist, and Sam eventually came to a very genuine conversion to the Christian faith. In the Baptist tradition, he overcame the bottle, largely overcame his anger. You really can't understand Sam Houston apart from Margaret Lee from Alabama.
So is he electable today?
Given what we just went through, probably. I'll tell you, we interviewed a number of people, Governor Perry, you know, several politicians that hold offices that he held. We interviewed Governor Richards, and I have this on tape from her. It was really funny. She was a delightful person to talk to. But she kind of chuckled and said, he couldn't get elected precinct chairman today. he didn't care what you think, frankly. He was going to do whatever he thought was right, and he paid the price for doing what was right. So, yes, sir.
I'm wondering, what did you find out about the Yellow Rose of Texas? I mean, how much of that is fantasy, how much of it is true? And I have a feeling that a lot of people, Texans running around out of their pickup trucks at a bar singing about the Yellow Rose of Texas, have no clue as to who she was.
No, she was, her name was Emily West. they recently found her indenture paper. She came from Connecticut. She was a free woman of color from Connecticut who came here on to attach to James Morgan on an indenture of servitude. She was not a slave in the sense that we're thinking of slavery here. She certainly wasn't at the Alamo. She was at San Jacinto. She probably was in Santa Ana's tent. As James Haley said in the film, he said, for many, many years, the Daughters of the Republic did not like for anybody to talk about anything as scandalous as the Yellow Rose, but she was probably there. Sam did not plant her there. Sam never met her, never knew her. She was swept up in New Washington when Santa Ana's group was chasing the government and they escaped, and they were in New Washington down on the coast south of Trinity Bay, or on Trinity Bay, just kind of south of La Porte a little bit. And she was picked up there, and she eventually made her way back to Connecticut. But yes, she was a real person, and yes, she was at San Jacinto.
So, she didn't have blonde hair and blue eyes?
No, I don't think she did. Let me, in honor of the clock and everything, let me just tell you a couple things about the film, and then I'm at your disposal, okay? We filmed this thing in 31 locations in 5 states. We filmed, it took us 5 years to get it done, and we filmed in the actual locations where these events we were depicting took place, as I said earlier, some of them. And then we also filmed in the same time of year. So when Sam met Jim Bowie in San Felipe, and they rode to San Antonio together, basically along I-10, we filmed, that happened in the first week of January of 1833, and so we waited and we filmed that in the wintertime. So the grass is dead and the trees are bare and the light is correct, and it's as historically close as you're possibly going to get. We interviewed the top Sam Houston scholars. Anything we've said about slavery, I'll let Randolph Campbell say it, because he's the go-to guy on slavery. These are top shelf, no dust scholars in this area. Randolph Campbell used to be the president of the Texas State Historical Association. He's not some kid, wet-nosed kid right out of school who thinks he knows everything. Anything we said about the Tejanos, I'll let Frank de la Teja say it, the first state historian of Texas and the chair of the history department at Texas State, and also a president of the Texas State Historical Association. Anything about Stephen F. Austin, I'll let Greg Cantrell comment on that. Stephen F. Austin's biographer, he's at TCU. So, you know, if anybody had any problem, my two criteria for the film was, it's got to be beautiful, because if Texas and Tennessee and Virginia are your canvas and you're a photographer and it's not pretty, then you need to find something else to do, you know. So it's got to be beautiful, and then the history has to be bulletproof. I mean, if we can't prove it, we're not going to say it. And we drove all the way to the bottom and found many things. I found a picture of William Stanberry. A lot of guys had heard the story of William Stanberry, but almost nobody had ever seen his picture. And I looked and looked and finally gave up. And this guy called me about 6 months later from the bowels of some library in Ohio. And he said, "You the guy looking for Stanberry?" I said, "Yeah." "Well, I got him." "You still want him?" And I'm like, "Yeah, I want his picture." So we found a picture of Sam Houston's first wife, which wasn't supposed to exist. Oh. And we were at the museum, and I say we found it. It showed up while we were in the midst of this. We were at the Sam Houston Museum in Huntsville on March 2nd one year, and this guy showed up, and he's a descendant of hers, and he had this picture, and jaws were dropping all over the place, and lots of scholars were there who were competent to weigh in on such matters, and they said, but she burned all of her pictures. She wanted to disappear, you know, and everything. And he said, well, she didn't burn them all. She didn't have them all. And so I made some calls. Here's an example. I called all those guys I just told you. And I asked them two questions. I said, first of all, can we use this picture, you know? And they all said, the provenance isn't airtight, but it's pretty good. And they said, it's certainly good enough to say it is believed by historians that this, the probability is very high, or something like that, that this is probably an authentic picture of the Lysel, which is different from just declaring it to be so. And then I asked him another question, kind of an ethical question, you know, should we use this picture? Do we owe anything to Eliza Allen? Are we under any obligation to honor her wishes to disappear from history or to not be seen or whatever? And all of them said in very strong language, absolutely not. They said, anybody she would have known has been dead for over 150 years. At some point, history takes over, and they said, you have a duty to use this picture, you have an obligation to use this picture. So I feel very comfortable that we were on very solid ground on that kind of thing. And that's how we did for 5 years. That's the granular level that we went to create this thing. So,
can we have a sneak peek? Do you have it on your...
I'll be glad to show you the introduction, sure. Let me pull that up, and let me unplug my mic here. This is a 5-minute thing. It's very short. It is kind of, like I say earlier, the Reader's Digest version of his life in 5 minutes. It'll give you a real idea of the look and feel of it. Let me just...
Here, I'll let you use this one.
Let's see. Oops.
Yeah, just plug it back in.
Plug this in here?
Yeah,
so
then this into here.
Okay, you got it.
All
right, here we go. We're going to... Let's turn my computer back on. Turn it off. We filmed in the Great Smoky Mountains during the peak of the fall leaves. It was miles and miles of paint. It was just beautiful. And the cinematographers were stopping, and they'd say, "Oh, stop! You know, I gotta shoot this vista. This is just awesome. I gotta get it." So we'd stop the truck, and we'd pull out all the cameras and all the gear, and they would shoot it, and we'd pile it all back in. You know, 45 minutes later, and we'd go, you know, a quarter of a mile down there. "Oh, stop!" And I said, "Guys, it's all beautiful. We're never gonna get out of here if we don't. Let's get what we came here to get, and then we'll take shots of opportunity. You know, and." Get other stuff. We shot in the Texas Hill Country when the blue bonnets were at their peak. And they were just, it had been raining that year, and they were absolutely beautiful. As pretty as I've ever seen. I've lived in Texas my whole life. Lived in Austin, the Hill Country, about 20 years. We hiked one night to the top of Enchanted Rock, where I used to camp when I was in college so much, and you almost can't get there now, it's so crowded. But we hiked up to the top of Enchanted Rock at 5:30 in the morning, and it was ink black. And we got up to the top and unpacked our cameras and everything and set up, and we filmed the sunrise from up there. And it was just, I'll never forget that. It's working on it. Here we go.
When was this made?
It aired for the first time in 2013. On PBS, and I was going to tell you, we were at the highest spot in Tennessee, a place called Cleanman's Dome, and it's in Great Smoky Mountains National Park, and we got up there, and it was, the weather was really crummy, so the pictures were ugly, and there we go, that's all my trash on my desktop. Here, let me do this. It'll eventually come up. And the weather was bad, so my in-laws lived about 2 hours from there, an hour and a half from there. And so we went to their house and crashed out for a couple days and let the front pass. And we went back, and it was absolutely spectacular. It was about 16 degrees up there, and the wind was blowing an honest 70 knots.
Oh, boy.
So guys had their cameras blowing over on these tripods. We had 50 pounds of weight on our tripod, and it was still shaking, and we had to take the shake out with software. You know, but it was, and we were sitting there, you know, some of those colds are just stinging. It feels like needles, you know. You ever been that kind of cold? And so we're sitting in the truck and with the hot chocolate, and we just let the camera roll to get the whole sunset and everything. And so it's got to go check the cameras. Can you go check the cameras? I got it last time. Because you had to take your gloves off, and the knobs are little bitty. It's kind of like our cars. You know, when I was a kid, we had big old knobs, and you just reach down and grab the knob and turn it. And now they're all these little bitty, you know, that's called progress or something. Okay, I'm working on this. There we go. Hey, look at that. Okay. Yeah, that's actually horrible. It looks better on screen. You get it on your TV, it'll look really cool. That's actually the shot I was just telling you about. Let's see. Light right here for this?
Sure.
Yeah. This is the introduction.
Was removed from office and forced into retirement and disgrace. one of the most interesting people in America's history, certainly, without a doubt, the most influential, the most intriguing governor that Texas ever produced, and I will suggest to you, ever will produce.
His was a career that Caesar's might have envied, but carried out in the face of crushing personal burdens that he had to overcome to fulfill his destiny. He was a great and iconic American, whose influence is indelibly carved into the landscape of the United States.